great to be able to share and preach God's word with you this morning. We're continuing in our series, Mark, where a couple of weeks ago we began speaking about and looking into one of the most important journeys in the history of mankind, Christ's journey to the cross. And today we're going to be looking at why he began that journey and why he started this journey to the cross. And so let's stand as we read Mark 14, verse 17 to 31. This is the word of God, and it says, "And it when it was evening, he came with the 12, and as they were reclining at the table and eating, Jesus said, 'Truly I say to you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me.' They began to be sorrowful and to say to him one after another, 'Is it I?' He said to them, 'It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the dish with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to that man whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that man if he had not been born.' And as they were eating, he took bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to them and said, 'Take, this is my body.' And he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. And he said to them, 'This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I say to you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God.' And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. And Jesus said to them, 'You will all fall away, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. But after I am raised, I will go before you to Galilee.' Peter said to him, 'Even though they will all fall away, I will not.' And Jesus said to him, 'Truly I tell you, this very night, before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times.' But he said emphatically, 'If I must die with you, I will not deny you.' And they all said the same." Let's pray. Father, we just want to honor you and glorify you this morning, Father. We want our hearts to be opened before you, to live in the revelation of who you are and the grace and the mercy that you showed us in the journey to the cross. May we always continually, through all our lives, live in that revelation, never forgetting it, never thinking we've arrived, but always realizing that we live this life that we live by faith and trust in the one who loved us and died for us. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Thank you. Sophie started us last week. We preached this amazing message of how our God is sovereign and how nothing surprises God. Because God is sovereign, he has a plan and he's able to overcome everything that comes against us. And it's in those upper room moments where he meets with us intimately and enables us and empowers us to overcome those problems and deals with our hearts. And Sophie spoke about the Passover, and I just want to touch on the Passover, because this is quite important for us to understand, that the Israelites were celebrating the Passover, remembering how God had set them free from Egypt. They were enslaved by the Egyptians, and God had come with miracles and power and plagues, and had set them free. And the way they celebrated the Passover was, as Sophie spoke last week, is that they would kill a sacrificial lamb and take the blood of that lamb and paint it on the doorpost, so that when the angel of death came by, the firstborn of the family would not die because of the blood that was painted on the wall, on the doorpost. And the Israelites were finding themselves in a similar situation, where they were celebrating Passover and they were still in captivity, not by Egypt, but by another nation, Rome. And they were hoping that Jesus, they were expecting a Messiah would come and overthrow the Roman Empire. And in doing so, they would finally have a king and become a nation again. And that's what their hope was. So they were celebrating the Passover, remembering what God the Father had done for them, and hoping that this Jesus would be the one who would set them free from their physical captivity. And Jesus had come and he was celebrating this Passover with his disciples, who had, again, feeling the same thing as the Israelites, believing that Jesus was the one who was going to supplant the Roman Empire, sit on the throne, and they would have places of authority with him. And if I had to sum up my preach this morning, I want to use an extract from a commentary that explains this portion of Scripture and what Jesus was attempting to do with his disciples and did do with his disciples. The commentary says this: in placing the Last Supper between the betrayal and defection of the disciples, Mark vividly conveys that the many for whom Jesus pours out his life includes his own companions around the table. The sin that necessitates the sending of God's Son is not someone else's sin. The sin of Gulgula or Nero, these are Roman emperors, they were tyrants, like Hitler, or the legion of tyrants ever since, but the sin of the tenants of his own vineyard, of his own disciples, of Peter and James, of you and me. Jesus is showing why he came. In meeting with his disciples intimately, he's showing them that they have missed the reason of why he came. He didn't come for their physical captivity. He came to set them free from a captivity that is eternal and that we all suffer because of sin. And so let's look at what Jesus is saying to them and how we are to deal and how the disciples react and how we are maybe learn from it and not react in the same way. So let's read what Jesus does. And when it was evening, he came with the 12, and he was in the upper room, as Surfi spoke about, meeting with them intimately. And as they were reclining at a table and eating, Jesus said, "Truly I say to you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." They began to be sorrowful and to say to him one after another, "Is it I?" He said to them, "It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the dish with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better that man not be born." I don't know about you, but whenever I read that scripture, I never read it in my context. It's always about somebody else. You know, why should I let this scripture examine my heart? I'm okay with God. This is what I'm thinking when I'm driving behind a guy on the highway who is driving extremely slowly, and I'm thinking, how dare this person drive at the speed limit in the fast lane? I will show him. And so I overtake him. And as I overtake him, I slow down and I give him the stare of death. And this guy is oblivious. He's talking to his passenger, doesn't know what's going on around him. And I'm even more irritated now because I'm feeling like an idiot. Why do I need scripture to examine my heart? When I read scripture, God is telling me I need to pray for that person. That person is denying God the Father. And I don't allow scripture to examine my own heart. But look at who Jesus is speaking to here in this scripture. He's not speaking to the crowds or to the Pharisees. He's not speaking in a public forum. But he's speaking to men who had given everything up and had been following him for 3 years. Men who called themselves friends of Jesus and whom Jesus called friends. And in an intimate setting, he addresses the motive of their hearts. And I don't know about you, but if a friend of mine who I've known for so long came to me and said, "Manny, you're going to betray me," I would be indignant. I would say, "How dare you say that? I've done so much for you." And I'm sure that's what the Israelites might have been, the disciples might have been thinking. "Lord, we've given everything up for you. We left our jobs to follow you. How can you say that we're going to betray you?" And I can imagine what was going through their minds, panicking. Because they knew in their hearts that Jesus was right. And they'd been caught with their hands in the cookie jar, so to speak. And this is the thing that the world and the devil would have us believe, that we don't need Jesus, that we're okay. And the world has sadly institutionalized religion to the point where it would say, if you come to church and if you do this and if you do the right thing, and if you follow this moral path, you're okay with Jesus. And I know because I was born into the Greek Orthodox Church. As a Greek, I was told, if you're christened in the Greek church, you're a Christian. And so when I grew up and I filled a form out that said, asked me what my religion was, in those days you still had those forms, I would say Christian. And I hated going to church. I hated it because I had to sit on this wooden pew, and for a young boy who had a skinny bum, a wooden pew really hurt. I hated it. I was bored. But as I grew up and I began to hear more about Jesus, I thought to myself, I'm okay with Jesus. I suffered those wooden pews. I better be okay with Jesus. But that's what the world would have us believe. There are so many people that come and go to church for all the wrong reasons. I've seen in my life when I've spoken to people, Christians and non-Christians, and I've asked them and I've told them about Jesus and the gospel, and they, and especially the non-Christians, they would say, why do we need Jesus? Why would a loving God send me to hell? I'm not like Hitler. I haven't done anything wrong. But that's what the devil would have us believe and blind us from the truth that we need Jesus. And we come to church, and I've seen so many, including myself, come to church sometimes for all the wrong reasons. Maybe the right reasons, and those reasons are very relevant. I've spoken to people who have said, I'm coming to church because we can't fall pregnant and we need a child. Coming to church because I need a job and I know God can answer that prayer. And there's nothing wrong with that. Those things are not wrong. But when those people get those things, you never see them again. They come at the expense of following Jesus. And for many people, sadly, Jesus is a person of utility rather than a person of beauty. You see, I listened to a sermon once that really offended me. It was by Tim Keller. He was a pastor, and he led a church in New York, sadly passed away from cancer last year. And he said something in the sermon that as Christians, we have the propensity to relate to Jesus in two ways. To relate to Jesus as Judas, or to relate to Jesus as Mary. And Surfy preached an amazing preach a couple of weeks ago showing us about Mary, how she broke this vase, this expensive vase of perfume, onto Jesus' feet and anointed his feet. And you see, we can relate to Jesus in those two ways. And sometimes we do it unknowingly. And for Judas, who was following Jesus, he had missed the revelation of who Jesus was. And for Judas, Jesus was about utility. It was about what he could get out from Jesus. And he was hoping that he would sit with Jesus in authority when he was reigning as king. But Jesus kept speaking about death all the time. And so Judas was thinking, I need to get something out of this. If Jesus is going to die on the cross, I'm not going to have wasted 3 years of my life following him and not get anything out of it. So he betrayed him. And sometimes we do it unknowingly, because what happens in our lives, it's human nature. We become entitled and we feel we've done and we follow Jesus in a certain way that he owes us. And for many of us, Jesus becomes a utility. But for Mary, it might seem like she did a useless act. She could have just as easily have spent money on a $1 flask of perfume and poured it out on Jesus' feet. It would have achieved the same thing. But for Mary, Jesus wasn't a person of utility. But he was a person of beauty who had given up everything, who had looked at her and forgiven her sin. And so she poured out everything that she had and saying to Jesus, you don't owe me anything. I give you my everything. And so the devil would have us believe and live in that place of, we don't need to allow the scripture to examine our own hearts because we're okay. But Jesus, in his amazing grace and his mercy and his love for us and for the disciples, shows us the way out. And this is where he introduces the Lord's Supper. And he shows us how the disciples can overcome this captivity that is eternal and not physical. And we read, and he says, and as they were eating, he took bread and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to them and said, take, this is my body. Take, this is my body. And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank it, and he said to them, this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for the many. Truly I say to you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God. Jesus was showing his disciples why he had come. He was showing them that he hadn't come for their physical captivity. And in fact, he was saying that if you follow me, You will experience even greater physical captivity. But he was saying, I've come because you are captive by your sin. And in speaking, he introduces the Last Supper, which was to replace the Passover, because he was showing them that he would become the sacrificial lamb that was slain on the cross. And his blood was poured out for our sins, just like the blood was poured out by for the lamb and painted on the doorposts. And when the angel of death came, it saw the blood and passed that house, and no death occurred there. Jesus dies on the cross. And when the angel of death comes and looks at us, he no longer sees our sin, but sees the righteousness of Christ on that cross, who became our substitute so that we might have everlasting life and be set free from the eternal captivity of sin. I remember as a 16-year-old child sitting on a cold floor again with my skinny bum in the school hall, listening to a man who was an ex-mobster. In fact, he was the godfather of the mafia in America, a man by the name of Joe Donato, and he had given his life to the Lord. And I remember sitting on this floor listening to him. And the reason I was there was because I could have got out of a school lesson and I didn't have to sit and listen to a teacher. But as I was listening to him, I wasn't bored. Because what this man was saying, he spoke about three men who had everything. They were religious men. They had everything in life. They had good families. They flew jets and had big houses and had all the money in the world. And I thought to myself while listening to him, I wouldn't mind having that. But then he said something that struck such a chord in me. He said, every single one of those three men committed suicide. And I thought, why would they do that if they had everything? And I'll never forget his next words. His words were, they had a black hole in their heart that they could not fill without Jesus. And as I listened to what he said, I realized that was me. I had a black hole in my heart that I could not fill without Jesus. And when he asked, who wants to put up their hand to receive Jesus as Lord and Savior? I didn't care what was going on around me. My hand shot up. And for me, in that moment, I realized that I needed Jesus. I was a sinner. And Jesus was the only solution to my captivity. The one who had given it all for me. And this is what Jesus wants us to live in the revelation. This is what has caused him to come from heaven and walk on this earth to live the life that we cannot live in our sin. To die the death on the cross. This is what kept him on this journey, this terrible journey to the cross, was because he loved us and knew that we needed to be set free from our captivity. So the question we have to ask ourselves is, how do we respond to Jesus and the cross? And we can respond in two ways, really. And let's have a look at what Jesus says next. And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. And Jesus said to them, you will all fall away, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. But after I am raised, I will go before you to Galilee. Peter said to him, even though they all fall away, I will not. And Jesus said to him, truly, I tell you, this very night before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times. But he said emphatically, if I must die with you, I will not deny you. And they all said the same. I want us to notice something, that Jesus never pointed out Judas's sin. He never said to the 12, Judas is the one who is going to betray me. Why is that? There's two reasons. The first is that he was trying to show the disciples that every single one of them had the same motive. The fact that Judas betrayed him, every single disciple did the exact same thing. They all left him when he was arrested. Their motive of their heart was wrong. They had misconstrued who Jesus is and why he had come. And the second reason is that Jesus loved Judas. We forget that sometimes. Jesus came to die even for Judas. And the hope of Jesus' heart has always been that every single one of us who are caught in sin, who are living in sin, have the opportunity to repent and to turn to him. And the hope of Jesus was that Judas would return and repent and return to him. Peter denied Jesus. And in my opinion, it's exactly the same sin as what Judas did. But Peter responded very differently to who Jesus was later on than the way Judas did. And Peter was caught like the disciples with his hand in the cookie jar. And I can imagine how he was feeling, like he was, you know what, Jesus is right, but it's not the truth though. I know I will die for him. I know I can go with him to the cross and follow him. And Peter, in his own strength and his love for Jesus, but in his own strength and in his own pride, because he was caught out, and as Peter is who he is and always puts his foot in it, decided to reveal to Jesus, no, I will follow you, Jesus. I'm not like the others. This word is not for me. And if I was Peter, I would have kept my mouth shut, because Jesus says in front of everybody, Peter, you're going to deny me. You're going to deny me. And Peter responded. Peter's response was a very human response. But here's the thing, and this is what I want us to see, and how Peter eventually was restored to Jesus. To Jesus. 2 Corinthians 7:10, and I'm reading from the Amplified Version. It says this: for godly sorrow that is in accord with the will of God produces a repentance without regret, leading to salvation. But worldly sorrow, the hopeless sorrow of those who do not believe, produces death. What is it saying there? What is the difference between godly and worldly sorrow? Worldly sorrow is, as I've said so many times already, is I got caught with my hand in the cookie jar. I don't know if you've ever, those who have children who have caught their children being mischievous and they've been found out, they're all of a sudden the most cutest and most angelic person on the face of the earth, and they will do everything in their power to love you and to cuddle you and say, Mommy, I'm sorry. But they're only saying that because they got caught. If they hadn't got caught, they would have just carried on going the way they're doing. And that's what worldly sorrow does. It shows us that, oh, we've been caught and our pride is hurt, and we will do everything in our power to justify and atone for what we have done, but not truly feeling remorseful for what we have done. But godly sorrow is that sorrow that Mary felt. I am a sinner, and I don't deserve the love of God, and yet He's giving it to me. He's extending His grace and His mercy to me. I am a sinner who does not deserve it, and yet Jesus, in His love and mercy for me, is giving it to me freely. Paul said in Timothy, he says that this is a worthy saying: Christ came to die for sinners, of which I am the worst. Paul lived in this revelation, not in a morbid sort of way where, oh, I'm a sinner, woe am I need to whip myself and blah, 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 fish cake. But he lived in the moment of, in the tension of, when I am weak, Christ is strong. And I want to remind you of a parable in the Bible where Jesus is speaking of two men who come to the temple to pray. And the one man comes to the temple and he prays and he says, God, look at all I've achieved and all I've done and how important I am. And for him, he's coming to pray to God because he prays in the way that God owes him for everything he has done. And then he speaks of the other man who comes before God praying and saying, Lord, I am not worthy of your forgiveness. I am a sinner. Please have mercy on me. James, it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. And here's the thing. As Christians, it's so easy to fall into the rut of religion, where it's about doing for Jesus and what we can get up for Jesus. And sometimes it happens very subtly. But the Word of God teaches us that we need to be coming before God and allowing the Holy Spirit to examine our hearts. David, who was caught in sin, he had committed adultery and killed Bathsheba's husband. He tore off his clothes and put on sackcloth and fasted, and we see his repentance in Psalm 51, how he turned back to God out of godly sorrow and asked for God to forgive him, to restore the joy of his salvation. But then in Psalm 139, he puts a check in his life to make sure that this doesn't happen again, and he prays and he says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." We're going to have communion now. And when Paul was speaking to the church in Corinth, one of the things he said to the church in Corinth, he said, when you take communion, examine your hearts. Communion is the Last Supper, the remembrance of what Jesus did for us on that cross. And we're going to do that. We're going to remember this morning what Jesus did on the cross. And I want us to just come before Him with open hearts this morning and let Him examine our hearts. And just as David prayed, show me if there is any evil or grievous way in me and lead me on paths everlasting. And there may be people here today, you've come to church for all the right reasons, but all the wrong reasons. And Jesus is knocking at your door this morning and saying, I am the solution, the way, the truth, and the life to your eternal captivity. And before we take the communion, as we're asking God to examine our hearts, ask Him to forgive your sin if you've never accepted Him as Lord and Savior. And ask Him to come into your heart as Lord and Savior. So worthy, so great.